The Drew Mariani Show is sponsored in part by St. Gregory Recovery Center. Information about the recovery programs can be found at relevantradio.com/.
Whatever.
This is the Drew Mariani Show on Relevant Radio.
Controversies surrounding freshman Congresswoman Ilhan Omar. Omar, one of only two Muslim women in Congress, both elected in this last election, has been attracting criticism for her commentary on Israel since before she got elected. Back in 2012, during the Israeli offensive in Gaza, Omar tweeted that, quote, Israel has hypnotized the world. May Allah awaken the people and help them see the evil doings of Israel. Last month, Omar seemed to imply that U.S. lawmakers' support for Israel is fueled by money, tweeting somewhat glibly, quote, it's all about the Benjamins, baby. And then amidst a bipartisan backlash, Omar apologized, writing, quote, anti-Semitism is real, and then adding, we have to always be willing to step back and think through criticism, just as I expect people to hear me when others attack me for my identity.
The Drew Mariani Show on Relevant Radio.
It's hurtful not just to me, but to many Jewish members I've spoken to.
Would you like to see an apology?
Well, she, more than an apology, I hope that we're able to educate all of our colleagues about appropriate statements. They're hurtful.
All right. You may have heard the Washington Post and MSNBC is one of the many media outlets reporting on Representative Omar's case. Have you been staying up to speed with this story? Yesterday, the House passed a resolution calling out anti-Semitism. And I want to talk about it with you today. Good afternoon. I'm Drew Mariani. It is good to be with you today. We'll take a look at this issue and much, much more. You're welcome also to join anytime you want. You know the toll-free number here, right? It's 888-914-9149, 888-914-9149. So basically, let me give you just a quick background on this. We'll get to that. We've been hearing, you know, news about the rise of anti-Semitism over in Europe. And I've been following that. It always amazes me. I never could get my head around why there almost seems to be a spirit of anti-Semitism. What is it? You know, that this attitude, this prejudice has continued for so long. And why are these people targeted? This has been particularly true in France. But this week in a town in Belgium, there was a Mardi Gras type parade that they had. And one of the floats featured two caricatures of Orthodox Jews sitting on bags of money. One of them had a rat on his shoulder. I mean, that is horrible. That is absolutely horrific. It's incredible that they're still using the same kind of propaganda that the Nazis used nearly 75 years ago after the end of World War II. We saw this, right? Britain is also facing its own problem with the Labour Party leader, Jeremy Corbyn. He's constantly, this guy, I don't know his marriage with him, he's constantly making these anti-Semitic remarks, and apparently a leak shows just a ton of complaints against the Labour members. So many of the parliament doesn't have enough staff to really investigate them. So, but it's not just a European problem. You know, we're also seeing it here in our own country. And I think we need to be incredibly sensitive to it. You know, we're seeing it even in Congress for the third time in 2 months now. The third time in 2 months. Representative Omar of Minneapolis, she tweeted out an anti-Semitic canard, and the House had planned a resolution condemning her for that. But then, of course, Nancy Pelosi, the Speaker, apparently kind of lost her backbone because that resolution got watered down so much into some sort of generic statement against hate that Representative Omar herself voted for it. You talk about dysfunction on Capitol Hill. Oh, come on. It's crazy. So Congress was unable to discipline, you know, one of its own who clearly made an anti-Semitic remark. Instead, they made excuses for her. But that's not the extent of it. Let me give you some of the basics on the story if you're not up to date on it. I don't know how much you know about Representative Omar. This comes from the Washington Post. Listen to this.
Was elected in 2018 as one of the first of two Muslim women ever elected to Congress. And as a Somali refugee, she has been critical of Israel and U.S.-Israeli policy. But this whole controversy really began over a tweet. Representative Ilhan Omar had tweeted, it's all about the Benjamins, baby, in relation to support for Israel among American politicians. What she was saying is that there's a big lobbying effort behind Israel and Israeli policy, but what others heard was an anti-Semitic stereotype around Jewish people and money. Republicans were quick in their condemnation.
The language they are using is wrong.
And the pile-on continued from within her own party as well.
Her remarks were reprehensible.
Democrats, including Speaker Nancy Pelosi, demanded an apology, and Representative Omar was quick to give that apology. And all seemed to be fine until another comment made by Representative Omar at a panel discussion where she suggested that some politicians had an allegiance to a foreign country. And there was another outburst of outrage.
When a colleague invokes classic anti-Semitic lies three times, then this body must condemn that anti-Semitism.
You know, some Democrats have been quick to condemn her statements. I want to applaud them for that. Senator Chuck Schumer is Jewish. He was asked about what she said. Here's what he said.
Every senator would condemn anti-Semitism. That's absolutely true. And I think that the bottom line is this. Congresswoman Omar said, I thought was wrong and hurtful, but I also want to say that what happened linking all Muslims to the terrorist attack was wrong and hurtful, and both should be condemned.
All right, Speaker of the House Nancy Pelosi made this statement too. Listen.
I don't think that that the Congresswoman is perhaps appreciate the full weight of how it's heard by other people, although I don't believe it was intended in any anti-Semitic way. But the fact is, if that's how it was interpreted, we have to remove all doubt, as we have done over and over again. We're working now on a resolution when we come to the floor that will again speak out against anti-Semitism, anti-Islamophobia, anti-white supremacy in all the forms that it takes, that our country has no place for this.
And again, I just reiterate a point I made a moment ago, and I'd love to hear from you, too. You can join us, 888-914-9149. Feel free to sound off on the issue. Again, the House planned that resolution Nancy Pelosi was talking about, condemning this anti-Semitism. It became like an anti-bigotry statement. It was so watered down. I mean, Pelosi really did not follow through on this. It was became so generic against hate that Representative Omar herself voted for it. You know, that's how ridiculous this has become. But one final thought here. I'm going to be joined by somebody who can shed some perspective on this, and of course I want to talk with you. Synagogues around the country, they've been getting marked. And I don't know if you've followed any of these or seen these stories being reported. They've been getting marked with swastikas. In Pittsburgh, there was a gunman who went in. He killed 11 members of the congregation, and he injured, I don't know how many others. And I just got an email telling me that. And I want to quote this. Listen, quote, true Israel and God, Yahweh's chosen people, are the white Caucasian, Celtic, Anglo-Saxon, Germanic, Scandinavian, and kindred people in the world today. That's what somebody wrote to me. And that, of course, is false. But that's the mindset of some people. I'm joined today by Roy Shoman. He's seen this stuff before. He's actually a convert from Judaism to our Catholic faith and the author of a couple books. I talked to him several times throughout the year. He's a very gifted author. He wrote a book called Salvation is from the Jews and also Honey from the Rock, but you ought to check him out. His website is salvationisfromthejews.com. And Roy, always a delight to talk with you. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. Thanks for having me. Something really struck me in your intro when you talked about the spirit of anti-Semitism and the mystery of anti-Semitism having been like a constant for virtually the last 2,000 years. And I actually think that's at the heart of the problem. I don't think anti-Semitism can be understood outside of salvation history, to tell the truth. It's just too irrational for having this one hatred to have been so prevalent basically almost everywhere in the world where there were Jews for 20 centuries. So I do think it's exactly what you said. I think it's a spirit, and I think it's a spirit that is opposed to Jews and Judaism precisely because our Messiah, Jesus Christ, was a Jew and came through Judaism.
I'm glad you said that because it's kind of a personal thought of mine. If you march across the centuries, you see this spirit rearing its ugly head in a lot of different ways. And I often thought, Roy, I said, why is there And why has there always been such a prejudice against the Jews? Is it because of something they did in the Old Testament period? From the old accusation, they so-called were Christ killers. I never bought into that. Where does it come from? So you just think that Satan has this ancient animus towards the chosen people, and that has continued to plague them across the years.
He has an animus against the chosen people because they brought about his defeat by bringing about the incarnation of Christ. He has an animus against Christ, and he can't really get to Christ, but he can get to his blood relatives, so to speak, who are the chosen people. And we know as Catholics from the Catechism of the Catholic Church, non-Catholic Christians know it too, but of course they don't respect necessarily the Catechism, that the Second Coming can't happen until there's a widespread conversion of the Jews. So he also has an animus against the Jews because not only did they play a crucial role in bringing about the First Coming of Christ, which is really Satan's definitive defeat, but they'll have a central role in bringing about the Second Coming of Christ, which will be wrapping up the entire game for Satan.
Yeah. Immediately after the Holocaust, there was a lot of sympathy for the Jews, at least in the West, and I think because of what Hitler did. I mean, clearly that was demonic, but you know that seems to run dry. Are we forgetting? Do generations forget what has gone on in the past? I mean, we always say we should never forget. Give me your take on that. How do we bring fairness and balance to this? Because if you look at Representative Omar and what she said, clearly her marks were anti-Semitic. Do you think that it was misinterpreted, as Nancy Pelosi said, or do you think that this generation, maybe her Islamic, I shouldn't say her Islamic background, but I mean, she comes from a different worldview. Maybe she does have a hatred or a dislike for Jews. I'm not quite sure how to read her comments. What are your takes on it?
I don't think one can have an intelligent version of this conversation without addressing the built-in attitude in Islam towards the Jews and the history of Muhammad's relation with the Jews. Because you said, like, is every generation condemned to forget the past? Well, the Muslims have not forgotten that Muhammad was killed by a Jewish woman, according to his earliest biographers and according to the Islamic scriptures. The problem isn't forgetting, the problem is a memory. And right, Muhammad had a continual warfare against the Jews. The Quran has any number of statements saying essentially the Jews are the vilest of creatures, Allah hates the Jews more than he hates anyone else, and so forth, that the Jews are descendants of monkeys and apes, and literally, which is still being said by Muslim clerics and so forth. So I'm not talking right now about Representative Omar, but the resurgence of anti-Semitism that you see is frankly, it's very linked to the growth of Islam in the West. You can't intelligently separate the two.
Let's do this. We'll take a few calls for you, too. If you want to join us, 888-914-9149. That's the number for you, 888-914-9149. Of course, we'd love to hear from you. Craig is listening in Minnesota. Craig, welcome.
Greetings, Drew. How are you?
I'm well, thanks. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks for letting me on. So, I live in the Twin Cities. So, Representative Omar and her predecessor, Keith Ellison, are both Muslims. And I appreciate the comment more than anything else about the "we will never forget." The rapid and visceral irony of the notion that we would elect members of Congress that are Muslims in the absence of at a minimum 9/11. But let's go specifically into her district. The district in Minneapolis that elected her has a population that they report is 70,000 Muslims. We argue those of us in the Twin Cities thinks it's a much substantially larger number than that. And your guest is 100% correct. I'm not denying it. Baked into the Muslim faith is a hatred towards Jews. So we should not be surprised anyway. We should mock and deride every single member of the Democratic Party that doesn't want to resoundingly reject what she's had to say. And then we should all ask ourselves, when you see the face of that congressperson on TV with that smirk on her face, the real story, the real investigative report would be to have somebody go back into a Muslim community outside of the United States and find out how loudly she's being cheered and supported for her great work to dismantle the Constitution of the United States, Christianity in the world, and destroy it. She's performing her own personal jihad, and somehow we've let that happen.
Well, I was going to ask you, Craig, you come from Minnesota. Tell me a little bit about the constituency there. How did she get elected?
That was a pure no-brainer. It's super easy. Number one, it's important, and I don't want to change the debate to immigration, but it's important that everybody understands that when immigrants come into, in Minnesota in particular, specific, they don't come here for all of the fine weather and all the fancy cooking and nicety of Minnesotans. They come here because we have an incredibly generous bonus system that pays them unending amounts of money, including 7 years without taxes being withheld from their payroll when they finally do get jobs. So the benefit to coming here, and then the chain migration that follows for it, is done exclusively for building and massively increase the size of the population in their own personal jihad to take over large sections of the portion of the community. And now look at, they're members of city councils, they're members of school boards, they have their own very own schools that don't teach anything related to the United States Constitution. They teach Sharia law in their own schools right here in the Twin Cities.
Hey, Robert, thank you.
Her election was a no-brainer.
Craig, thank you. Thanks so much for your call. Roy, I'm going to let you respond to some of the comments he made. Clearly, we saw a lot of this in Europe. I hate to see it rear its head here in the States, but I'll let you address some of the points he brought up.
Well, he mentioned the cheering that Ilhan Omar might be getting in the Arab world. Her heroism hasn't escaped David Duke, the former Grand Wizard of the Ku Klux Klan, right? He gave her a rave review for her statement by saying that by defiance to the Zionist occupation government, that is, of course, the U.S. federal government, Ilhan Omar is now the most important member of the U.S. Congress. So if you can judge somebody by their who their friends are and who their enemies are, remember the condemnation that Trump got because David Duke expressed some support, even though, you know, Trump denounced such support. I don't have to take issue with anything that
right.
the caller said.
Right. No, I agree with that. I do find it interesting, though, that, you wonder if there's some other agenda here, because this is not the first time statements like this were kind of made, but we'll see. I don't want to read too much into it, but I do want to kind of wave the flag to warn people to be vigilant against this type of behavior. Robert's listening in Brooklyn, New York. Robert, welcome. You're on the air with Roy Schoeman.
Hi. So I think the Congress lady exercised her freedom of speech. Now, she said three things. First, she says that money, $100 bills are a response. She never said Jewish money. She simply said Benjamins, which are $100 bills, are responsible.
You can respond directly to him when he's done.
Never said Jewish money. Secondly, she said that congressmen and senators are pressured to support Israel. Now, my father's Jewish. My father is a white German Jew. And the USA, the United States, gives Israel $10 million every day, part of a $38 billion 10-year budget. $10 million every 24 hours goes to one of the smallest countries in the world, Israel. If anyone criticizes Israel, over within an hour, bloggers, the newspapers will tear these people apart. This little poor congresswoman said that she was pressured upon entering the House of Representatives to support Israel. No ifs, ands, or but. It's almost like they're twisting arms to support Israel. Let me just say something about the money. And she's right. According to Forbes magazine and the New York Times, Jewish Americans give 50% of all the campaign contributions to the Democratic Party, 50%, and 30% of all Republican donations come from the Jewish community. Now, the Jewish community is only 2% of the population. So 2% of the population is given 70% of all campaign contributions, and they expect something in return.
All right, Let me hold you there, because I don't have a whole lot of time. There's a lot of people who want to get on the conversation, too. Let's respond to that, Roy. Your take on that, what she said?
Actually, I have a lot of sympathy with some aspects of what the caller was saying. Frankly, the Chinese government contributes money to politicians, even though it's illegal, in order to get, you know, policies passed that benefit China. I wish it weren't true, but it is true that a lot of lobbying goes on. And I mean, there was a book a number of years ago written called, excuse me for saying it, Parliament of Whores, you know, about representative government. I mean, it's a problem. And it is true that there is a pro-Israel lobby that does make contributions that are reflect how pro-Israel the congressman is. So that part of that is true, and that part of it actually think is a little unfair. And if Representative Omar, how can I put this? If it wasn't in the context of other reflections of anti-Semitism, I think that one could legitimately object to the fact that the interests of other countries are represented in Congress as a result of lobbying funds, but then you should be even-handed about it, and Israel isn't the worst or the biggest. And I mean, you look at the accusations about the Saudi influence over the U.S. government because of the, you know, probably billions of dollars, frankly, that they funneled through lobbyists to U.S. congressmen and so forth. So that aspect of it is, I think, how can I put it? One has to separate out the right. history of anti-Semitism that you see coming from Representative Omar, and with the fact that, yes, it is true that lobbying takes place in Congress and there is a pro-Israel lobby.
She says Israel has hypnotized the world.
Exactly.
And, of course, the Senate Minority Leader Chuck Schumer, he found her statements offensive, though, in the way he interpreted one of her colleagues. He saw it as an anti-Semitic stereotype, found it offensive and irresponsible, these comments about all the Benjamins.
Well, would he have if his constituency was 70% Muslim instead of 70% Jewish, right?
Yeah.
I mean, I don't want to, you know.
No, I get you. No, I think I want to have a fair discussion here. I think that is a great and great point. I want to go back to the phones. Before I do, though, I want to get to the House resolution here that was passed yesterday. It ended up being kind of mushy and worthless. What do you think that says to the nation? Why not a more distinct, clear statement than this watered-down one that even Omar herself voted for?
I think this is in part is political correctness. They can't bring themselves to condemn anti-Semitism without in the same breath condemning, quote, Islamophobia. You know, this is like the parent who assumes, you know, that if the children are fighting, they're equally guilty, so you have to kind of be even-handed, even though one might be the devil's child and the other might be an angel. This myth of Islamophobia has been created, and it gives you know, in the politically correct culture, it gives an equal legitimacy to saying anything negative about Islam or Muslims with saying anything negative about Jews or Judaism. Now, I will fully acknowledge that it's just as evil to say anything negative about Muslims as it is to say about Jews.
Amen.
But it's not equally guilty to say that Islam as a religion teaches certain things which are abhorrent to our sensibilities, whereas Judaism as a religion doesn't.
Yeah, that's a great point. That is an excellent point. You know, some people claim that Omar wasn't criticizing the Jews but Israel. And I think that's, let me get back to that point. She was clearly, you know, here's my question. Let me do it this way. Does criticizing Israeli policy bleed into anti-Semitism in some respects? Or are those two too intricately connected now that you can't condemn Israel for certain things without being viewed as anti-Semitic?
I actually think the better way to phrase that is, does anti-Semitism bleed into anti-Israel attitudes? In other words, I would agree that one should be able to be as critical of the wrong done by Israel as one wants, if one's fair-handed about it, and that's not anti-Semitism. However, if one condemns in Israel behavior which is far worse in 60 other countries about which one keeps their mouth shut, then there's something wrong with only condemning it in Israel.
Yeah. All right, well, I want to thank you for being with me. I only have about a moment left. A lot of people wanting to join the conversation. If people want to get a hold of your books, too, Salvation is FromTheJews.com, is that the best place, or what would you recommend?
Well, they're both published by Ignatius Press, so they can get them from Ignatius.com, and they're both kind of mass market books in a way, so you can certainly get them from any internet bookseller or Barnes & Noble or any place.
Well, look, we'll talk more. I'd love to get you back on to share your own conversion story, and as we get close to you know, the holy days and Easter, you and I always have great conversations. So I always appreciate your work and your perspective. Roy, thank you for your time.
Thank you. Keep up the good
work.
All right,
that's Roy Shoman. You can check him out. Salvation is from the Jews and Honey from the Rock, two excellent books.